play with Frank Zappa, Steve Vai, Alan Holdsworth. We constantly watch the 1984 Japanese Live videos on YouTube because they're fantastic. And he's got a new CD called Dreams, Nightmares, and Improvisation. And without further ado, I'm going to let you guys listen to Chad Wackerman. Give it up. Fantastic.
I personally want to thank everybody at the store. They've been really super organized and made this sound check and everything incredibly easy for me, which is not always the case. So I really do appreciate that. What a great facility. Anyway, I mean, you guys are very, very lucky. Also, need to thank Evans, DW, and Peisty. And Paul is here from Peisty if you have any really specific questions about some of the cymbals. So beyond that, I'm just going to play for you for a while. Pretty rare that any, you know, there's certain families, the Picaros, the Fowlers, Escovedos, you know, but there's not that many families who have all the siblings or musicians, and it really comes from the inspiration that we had from our father, which really taught us, if you really want to do something, it takes a lot of work, and you have to really dedicate a lot of time to it and a lot of effort, otherwise, why do it? When I was young, my father wrote a letter to Louis Belson asking if I could take drum lessons from him. And Louis, being the complete gentleman that he always was, wrote back handwritten 4-page letter basically explaining how busy he was with his then wife, Pearl Bailey. And he had his own big band and didn't really have time to teach, but he recommended that I go to his teacher. His teacher was a man named Murray Spivak. As far as California went, he was the guy to go to fix your hands. He was really old school, he was really tough, but he had this amazing system. He used to teach every 2 weeks because he would give us so much material that we had to practice for a minimum of 2 hours a day that you couldn't take a lesson before then, you wouldn't be ready. So our setup was a practice pad, a mirror right in front of our pad so we could, as well as seeing your grip this way, you can look back at it this way, which is a great help. A metronome and a clock. Okay, everything was timed out for all of his exercises, and you had, once you were playing something correctly, then you start timing yourself. He was big on economy of motion and getting a lot of power when you need it without muscle. He wanted to get the stick to work for you on a lot of these exercises so you weren't having to work hard to motivate the stick to get notes out. Now, he would police this at the lesson to make sure you had absolutely zero tension going on in your hand. If you felt anything tense at all, he would stop you and say, look, you've got to take a break. You're going to hurt yourself. But I was so lucky to be able to take lessons from him. I mean, he was a hardcore teacher. You know, I had one, everybody had their one story of not practicing enough. If you'd only practice an hour a day or something, he knew right away. He could just tell. He'd been teaching for so long. And it would just be, well, why would you come in here? How could you be come all this way and not be prepared? You know, maybe drumming isn't for you. You know, completely serious. And as a little kid, that was a serious thing to have Murray Spivak tell you that. He used to say, the faster you play, the more relaxed you should be. And everybody does the opposite. Okay? He said, if you do the opposite, if you tighten up, you're going to have a ceiling, which maybe if you tighten up a little bit more, you can get a little bit faster than that, but you'll never get beyond that. And I really do think it's true. And I'm really a big fan of his system, because when I got the job of Frank Zappa in 81, when we were rehearsing, playing really loud, like arena kind of volume at rehearsals 8 hours a day for 3 months, I never had any hand problems. I never had any muscle issues at all. And I really, really thank Murray for that.